Hello, everybody. Welcome to this Miraculous's online summit. I have a line of guest speakers here, and I will introduce Dr. Nikhil Agarwal, who is the moderator. Nikhil is the CEO of IIT Kanpur and has had an illustrious career. Dr. Nikhil Agarwal used to be the CEO of in Andhra Pradesh before. He's been with FICCI. He's also has a fantastic experience in terms of as a professor, as an innovator, a visionary, and he's the man today in charge. So I wish Nikhil that you have a great conversation with the fantastic speaker line that we have, and I'm sure the audience will be able to draw a lot from the discussions that you guys are going to have. So all the best, and look forward to hearing you guys. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Iftikhar. It's such a pleasure to be here. And I was just making a comment. It's so nice to see the advancement of technology. Like many of us go and attend conferences, speak there every now and then. But now, using technology is the first time I am hosting a moderation panel on a conference setting. And Zoom, I'm sure everybody is now pretty accustomed to. Not only you, your wife and your kids are very accustomed to as well, but hosting a conference in such an interesting way is certainly good. I think the technology is shaping up, and as a incubator CEO, I certainly welcome that change. We have a fantastic panel today. The topic is also quite interesting. It's sustainability and India's outlook for renewables. As we all know, the energy sector has changed within the last 3 months' time, and there are a lot of changes which is happening in the last few years. Certainly, those ideas will be reflected upon this panel. But before I go forward, I would like to introduce quickly my panelists. We have Advait Joshi, we have Gaurav Sood, and we have Raghuram Chandrasekaran. I will not go into the profile of them because I want them to speak about their work, about what they are doing for a minute, and then we can go to the topic. So before I proceed, I would like to tell a little bit more about what we do at IIT Kanpur. IIT Kanpur, as you know, this is the fourth oldest IIT in the IIT system. SIIC, which is the more common brand name that we use for the incubator, is a 20-year-old incubator. We are one of the oldest in the country. We have close to 100 companies now incubated with us, and many of them are in renewable state. Energy is like one of the core sectors for us. We are the leading institution for computer science, for biosciences. Number of companies that we have are doing work on renewable energy. I'll give you a few examples and cases as we go along, which are the people who are working in renewables. Lately, in the last 3 months, when the COVID situation started, the Government of India approached us and asked that, can you provide certain solutions in COVID-related situation? And we came forward along with many other IITs, and you'll be glad to know that some of the work that we have done the last 3 months have been tweeted by Honorable Prime Minister himself, which is certainly quite heartening for. And now what we want, as we go along, the requirements in the energy for the home, for the office, for your own cars, for everything is changing. And this session will reflect upon how these market and the generation capacity will change in years to time. So my request to my fellow panelists is, because we have only 15 minutes, we will keep our sessions very crisp. My request is, whenever the question is asked, kindly answer it in within 3 minutes, not more. And the first round, we will do a quick round of introduction. Kindly take 60 seconds of your time in telling a little bit about yourself, your organization, and the reflection what the work you're doing. So we'll start with Gaurav Sood.
Yeah, hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gaurav Sood. I'm the CEO of Spring Energy, which is a large-scale, utility-scale renewable power producer. We set up large solar and wind farms and produce energy and supply to the grid. Our off-takers are usually government entities, government distribution companies. I've been a part of this sector for more than a decade. have seen the solar tariffs in particular falling from as high of 18 rupees to around 2.5 rupees in the country currently, and the trajectory is going to be the same in the same direction. Earlier we used to fight on the basis of clean energy. Now we are let's say mainly our stay is primarily on account of competitive energy. Yeah, so I think that's a brief introduction. Thank you.
So certainly one question to you, Gaurav, would be in the coming time, like you said that the energy prices are decreased from 18 rupees to 4.5 rupees. So what is the way out? Like, how the energy companies will do? We'll pass this question as we go along. Advait.
Hi. Thank you, Nikhil. First of all, let me thank Miraculous and the entire partner team for organizing this event and inviting us to speak. And but at the same time, I also want to apologize that, because of the gender imbalance that we have on this panel. But it was exciting to see so many powerful women making great statements on how the impact can be accelerated. It was really wonderful hearing them since the morning. Let me take a small minute on introducing Clean's work with you. So Clean is a network organization. We are connected with more than 210 decentralized renewable energy organizations across India. We, along with our members, are committed to unify, support, and expand the impact that is being created through decentralized renewable energy technologies. Technologies such as mini grids, microgrids, hydro picos, then biogas, biomass. So think of anybody which is off-grid in nature and is for local consumption. Many of our members serve rural communities specifically, and they go beyond energy access. They create solutions and technologies which enable not just energy generation, but for also utilization it for generating livelihoods, looking at better healthcare infrastructure, improving the education delivery mechanisms, and overall societal impact. And that is where we look at the sustainability for from our lens. I'm glad to say that Raghu is also one of our members, and in fact with IIT Kanpur we have been working with Udyama, who is also one of our members. Thanks.
So very important network. Like, we require such kind of network in India, where India is still energy deficit in all terms, we know about it. And your kind of network can find out solution that how every single Indian, every single citizen can get access to the clean and green energy that we talk about. So thanks a lot and welcome, Advait. Over to Raghu, please.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Vishal, and thank you, Miraculous, for giving me this opportunity, and thank you, Nikhil. So, Ehands Energy is a company that I founded about 9 years back. We are into the last mile energy provisioning. So, we work at high altitudes, and the microgrids that we run are largely in Uttarakhand, Himachal, Sikkim. These are what we call as off-road, off-grid, off-network, and most off-civilization, microgrids, very small communities. So that's the primary social impact work that we focus on. In addition to that, we work in different parts of the country in providing the last mile energy, which are energy deficient, parts of the country where the grid is not reliable. Where we fulfill the the energy requirement with our systems. And we take care of the social impact. We design everything from the livelihood and the social impact, be it a school or a primary health center or a micro enterprise in the village. So largely, everything is improved. We have more than 700 installations across India in a distributed capacity of almost 2 megawatt. So you can imagine, every system is like 1 kilowatt, 2 kilowatt, 3 kilowatt, 700 plus and still counting. And one of the measures that we because we are focused on bringing people into the financial inclusion. We track the number of people who have come into the Prime Minister Jan Dhan Yojana. So we alone have enabled close to 3.2 million people into the PMJDY by giving solar power to the regional rural banks and cooperative banks. So I've been in this development sector for almost two decades now. So more as we go. Thank you.
Very nice. In fact, 2015 was a watershed moment for India. If you all recall, the Prime Minister Modi in November announced the International Solar Alliance, which is eventually being joined by 121 countries. The idea was that reduce the dependence on the and increase the dependence on the solar energy and renewable energy. The Prime Minister coined a very interesting term called Surya Putra, all the sunshine countries which are joining in. And certainly out of all the brightest of the countries, I think India is Surya Putra. We are blessed with solar energy all the way. There are a number of topics that are emerging on this panel, like decentralized renewable energy, solar energy, distributed, and how we can use in sustainable development goals. So taking this forward, so how do you feel? I would like all the panelists to reflect upon for a minute or so about the topic itself. How do you feel this India outlook for renewable will change given the current COVID situation, and how to make it more sustainable? We'll start with Advait.
Great. Thanks, Nikhil, for the question. I think it's a very important question, and especially on both the fronts, not just on the renewable energy front, but overall the term that we use, sustainability, as a whole. Just let me put in a few figures in front of you that will help you understand how we look at it, especially in the COVID times, right? We have seen that there is a huge migration of workers who have been working in urban cities back to their homes. Now, on the same side, what we are seeing is close to 26.3% of rural health subcenters and roughly about 4.8% of primary healthcare centers today are still choked with energy. They still don't have access to proper, whether it is electricity or thermal energy. And that is the kind of load that we are looking at in terms of servicing this change of, community being addressed. Similarly, what we are seeing is that there is going to be immense requirement for livelihood generation and income generation at the grassroots. So for example, another 34 million rural micro enterprises that exist in India, out of them 14% even today look for reliable energy to continue their business. So that is the kind of outlook that I see for renewable energy to expand beyond the large utility-based solutions as well. From our perspective and perspective of our members, we do look at sustainability from these angles, where energy access goes beyond for end product utilization. So that is how we look at the ecosystem and how sustainability and renewable energy will play a role in India ahead. Nikhil, I think you're on mute.
Yeah, sorry. So you mentioned about the reverse migration. Certainly 2 crore people have gone back in the last 3 months' time. So that will increase the dependency on energy, particularly in the class B, class C and villages area. Certainly this is very, very important to be issue which you have raised. I would request Raghuram to reflect upon how India outlook for renewable has changed during this time.
Yeah, thank you, Nikhil. Very interesting. As Advait said, I think everything has to be relooked at. All of our strategies have to be relooked at in the current scenario of COVID impacted economy. So, to us, for example, we are one of those enterprises which I wouldn't say very busy, but we are under tremendous pressure to keep all the rural installations going, because we provide the energy to the banks, regional rural banks and microfinancial institutions and NBFCs. And because the government is doing DBT, direct benefit transfer, and the money is going only into the Prime Minister's Jan Dhan Yojana account. There's a pressure in the villages to actually open these accounts if they don't have one. So we are under unusual pressure. I've never had a call from India's largest private bank, the vice president level, saying that by a branch sticker in Bihar. So that's the level at which the activities are buzzing in rural. And there's a group of people. So I say like this, these migrants who are, it's wrong to call them migrants. I mean, these are people who are settled in Bombay or Delhi or Pune or wherever, and they've gone back to the villages, and they've not gone back empty hand. They've gone back with tremendous skills. So for the first time, the country is actually facing a situation where the cities are going to run out of skills and the villages have tremendous skills. And we are trying to look at least one or two segments where we can provide energy-centric, productive help to them. And I think it's very doable. And what is missing is some policy framework at the state level. And also the financial institutions are not geared up to give loans quickly to these people who are likely to become micro-entrepreneurs. You know, so I'm working with a group of 25 hairdressers in a district in Bihar. They have come back from Maharashtra and they want to set up state-of-the-art saloon. And they are asking me to include the cost of the solar plant in the loan that they want from the bank, you know. So because they are very smart, they can go to the NBFC and take a loan. So I think, to me, this looks like this disruption is a huge opportunity also for change. And as far as, you know, the energy attitude is concerned in India, it is still seen as something very rare, privileged, difficult thing to have. So I think we have to change the mindset. We have to make it energy abundant, you know, in abundance for the country. And we as an enterprise, we work on the frontiers of, the Himalayan ecology. So to us, sustainability in terms of the climate change is very, very important. And we consider the carbon footprint reduction that we do in Himalayas as what we call as a premium carbon reduction, because every ton of carbon dioxide saved in some of these important areas like Nanda Devi biosphere and those sensitive zones are actually
going very slowly. We have a constant number of 100.
So, you know, we see that the migrants have gone back. Some of them may come back, some of them may not come back. We need to find a structure by which we leverage their skills and create what I call as RTU, rural urban
economy. I have access to.
Thanks, Raghu, for giving me one clue. I am writing an article for Economic Times about the reverse entrepreneurs, you know. So thanks for giving me. I think very important point you have given, that the first time in the history of India, the villages are skill surplus. Not a topic for this particular forum, but I absolutely agree with you. Over to Gaurav.
Yeah, thanks, Nikhil. So very clearly, I would bring out the utility scale perspective. And during these COVID times, one thing which has been proven very clearly is that, we were able to set up renewable energy plants. We were able to operate these renewable energy plants when we compare them with respect to thermal plants, etc., which faced issues with respect to fuel, etc. So that's the first aspect which we really were able to make sure that this essential service was provided, and everyone appreciated that in the ecosystem. The other key aspect which is very important is that during these tough times of COVID, with the entire economic activity coming down, the other challenge which was seen is that the demand for the distribution companies has fallen drastically, because industries are shut down, your commercial establishments are shut down. So it was a big challenge for the distribution companies. How do they manage this scenario of lower demand, and whereas supply was there. So we faced two key challenges. One was that some states tried to say that we are not going to buy this power, whereas for renewables, it's a must-run status, which is very important to be protected. And second, other aspect is that these distribution companies said that they are not getting paid. People in lockdown can't come and pay them, so because they can't be paid, they can't pay to us for the power we are supplying. So both these things were not critical learnings. Which also have impact going forward, because one thing which we are seeing, if you see at a global, at a broader level, today almost all states are power surplus. Please don't mistake when I'm saying power surplus at a macro level. We are not saying, we all are aware, a lot of people are not serviced, but to the people who are not serviced, states look at this as a power surplus scenario. So we have a lot of IPPs whose power purchase agreements, they have won bids, they want to set up the projects, but there is no state which is ready to buy power even at, let's say, 2 rupees 70 paisa to 3 rupees. So that is the sort of, I would say, issue which has come up. The other key issue is that because of the financial distress of our distribution companies, which is, we all know, because we keep on giving subsidies free power, the other big challenge is that the power purchase agreements, which were signed at higher tariffs, for example, renewables, we know that they have followed a dropping price trend, they are not very reluctant to buy those or to honor those payment obligations. So that is why some of the amendments which are being talked about in the new Electricity Act amendment are very, very critical, which the central government is trying to push, where they are trying to take the power from the state regulators in terms of determining what tariff should be paid by industry, what tariff should be paid by residential, and any subsidies, if have to be given, they need to be given in the form of any other direct benefit transfer to the people. I think this is very important to make sure that this sector and its overall infrastructure and the entire ecosystem is protected, and this Electricity Act amendment becomes very critical. So once again, I mean, the COVID times have shown the robustness of the renewable power generation, but it has also brought out that some key reforms need to be addressed on very high priority if we want this clean renewable sector to be a sustainable sector in the long run. Thank you.
Policy reforms, I think this is the message which Gaurav is saying, that immediate policy reforms are needed from the government. And certainly, it's. I absolutely agree with you. The purchase agreement, which has been done, and there was a case about Andhra Pradesh when the government changed, they renewed. So the power companies have gone through tizzy. So there, it has to be watertight. It has to be in such a way that, regardless of political turmoil or anything, the interests of the companies and the customers should be serviced. I absolutely agree with you. My next, so there are a number of questions which people are also sending. We will try to keep last 15 minutes for this Q&A. So I'll try to ask one or two more questions so that we can finish our discussion in 10 minutes. The next point which I want to raise about the energy innovation. During the beginning of the session, I mentioned about IIT Kanpur has played a very major role in COVID time innovations. So some of the activities that we have done were in ventilator space or disinfection tunnel stage or PPE, they were all lauded and appreciated. Can we do something similar in energy? I know energy innovation takes time, and IIT also, we have a number of companies which are doing some fantastic work. One of them I can mention is Off-Grid Energy Labs, which is making a zinc gel battery, is a proprietary technology. We are watching them very closely, I can say, and there could be some significant innovation is coming in the next few months' time. So the kind of companies like Off-Grid, company like we have drone companies which are working on energy space. So what kind of energy innovation is coming in? That's my first question. Or would you like to see in this 2020? I'll start with you.
Raghu or I?
Raghu.
Yeah. Raghu.
Yeah, okay. Yes, I think this is very interesting for us because we produce energy in a local manner, and it is, you know, that is a DC energy, and we end up converting it to 230 volt AC to be fed to the appliances. So for the last few years, the focus has been, if it is an off-grid situation, can we create a whole range of appliances which are DC powered? So I think we are more like, as a company or as an enterprise, we are more like a system integrator. So I would buy any equipment that is good for our customers. But we would like to see more and more innovation happening. But we have already, for example, we have got, you know, fan, energy efficient fan in the country, which is now taking only 28 watts. And we have DC refrigerators, which consume very low power. We have DC mixers, we have DC grinders, we have DC powered oil mill extractions, and we have now DC mill, DC powered spinning mills for weaving. So we are seeing a lot of innovations, and I think this is the right direction to go. What is missing is the standardization of this, you know, the technical specifications and standards. We have a subcommittee in Clean, where I'm the chair of that, where we are trying to put together the standards and go and tell the government, different agencies, that this is the standard that we all have agreed to, and if the government can value add to that, and then we will take it to the underwriters laboratory or wherever it needs to be tested for safety. So I see a lot of innovation happening at the ground level, and that is very encouraging, and we would like to encourage more and more youngsters to come into that space. There is tremendous scope. There has been DC TV and all those entertainment things, but on a productive level, what we call as productive microgrids, we are beginning to see those changes. And I think that's very good. But what is important is, in the context of COVID, and then in the context of self-reliance, to be made in India, to be designed in India. So what is lacking is, you know, for some reason, these kind of, low tech or low end product, they're never made with high quality. This is not the way the Japanese work. Even if they make a small safety pin, it would be of high quality. Somewhere that's not a problem only with our industry. It's a problem across the nation, you know. Even after so many years, you know, no disrespect to the largest car maker in the country, but there is no indigenous car from India which can match the quality and superiority of a BMW or a Mercedes, even if I want to pay that kind of money. So there is something lacking in our finesse, you know. So because I was a quality engineer in my early stage, and I worked on design, and I see that something is lacking. So that's one thing that we would like to bring in to these products, and that would make it very robust for our nation, and also we can export it, you know, to the African nation. But this is the way it's going to go in large part of South America, and also large part of Africa. Off-grid will be the way forward. So we see the need for innovation.
Thanks a lot. I think I like what you have said about the perfect product. That is something which the Chalta Hai approach has to go from India, and I think we are all realizing that's not going to work. Even the Indian consumers are not ready to buy the Chalta Hai product, whether it's a renewable energy or car or a pin. I absolutely agree with you. Over to Gaurav. What kind of energy innovations are coming in? How would you like to see?
Sure. I'm going to say some of the innovations they have started picking up, or the new technologies, I would say. For example, one key challenge when we set up solar plants, since these are utility scale, for example, our single project would be spread over a 1500 acre area of land. Now, to clean these panels is a humongous task. And whatever we say in India, the dust is a very big factor, and soiling leads to a lot of losses. And also we end up utilizing a lot of water in cleaning those panels. So we have moved to using a robotic cleaning, where basically a robot, everything is completely automated, and a panel and a robot is running with using a brush or some other mechanism over your panels on a daily basis, and you are able to save your soiling losses, and you are able to save water, which is all the more scarce because of these, the locations of these plants in pretty arid and sunny regions. So that's one thing which we are seeing, and we as a responsible organization would like to implement robotic cleaning across our plants. In addition to that, there is, you know, you mentioned about drones. For example, our entire today scanning in terms of your thermal scanning of your panels, your which is done, again, as I said, 1500 acres of land. If everyone starts going to each and every row or array of a solar plant, it will take a lot of time. So we are using using drones. We, you know, all these thermography, etc., is done, which brings out which all locations of our are disconnected, panels are broken, need to be changed, etc., so that this is utilized in a very effective manner. In addition to that, I would say generally technology itself is maturing, and innovations on the solar panel side. Earlier we used to have poly, then mono. Now we are seeing a lot of bifacial panels. We're having panels having basically a generation surface on both sides. Again, these are good things which are there, which have picked up really big time in other geographies. They are still new in India because of our balance of system costs are very competitive. When we have to use this panels, it's still not fitting into our overall economic equation. Once it happens, it's again good, because from the same amount of land you are using, you are generating much more energy. So I mean to say, these are some of the innovations in addition to all the other technological advancements. We are moving to bigger block sizes. We are moving to higher voltage levels to make sure losses are minimal, so that the energy is transferred. Another key important is a very, very precise forecasting and scheduling, which is also very important from a grid stability point of view, which is very key requirement of the grid today, which again, people are taking data and trying to improve it, but still a lot of improvement needs to happen. I think one last thing which I would like to touch upon is primarily on the storage side. With renewables becoming very competitive in general, we are all looking at storage to be the next key technology to play an important role in terms of its cost coming down, so that we can remove the intermittency out of storage, intermittency out of renewables, and make it a let's say around the clock sort of power. We can set up larger capacities, generate more PLFs, but yes, competitive storage. Once it happens, it would really change the dynamics altogether. So I think that's another area where a lot of innovation is happening, but a large-scale deployment is still to be seen, and cost to come down.
So you mentioned about the robots cleaning. So one of the companies, IIT Kanpur, is involved in the similar activities for local robotics, and they're the one who, I'm not sure whether you have interacted with them, but if you clean them, I can really certainly connect. So anybody interested in interacting with any of our companies, whether it's Off-Grid or Noka or any of the drone company, you can send me an email. I'd be delighted to make a connection so that you can collaborate. We should learn to work together. That's what one of the messages I'd like to say. Over to Advait. Energy innovations, what you like to see?
Great. I think Gaurav and Raghu covered large part of the innovations that are required at the large scale when we're looking at an overall energy point of view. I would like to take a step a little bit deeper in, and looking at, different kind of innovations that are happening. Again, looking at, how energy creates an impact on the ground. So take an example of what some of our members are doing in innovating their products. So one of our members is David Dayal Solar, who have come up with a DC-powered, small refrigerator, which now is also being tried out for, vaccine storage, considering COVID-19 equipments. Such innovations have the potential to create a strong economic impact at the grassroots, where either a local business person can use something like this to increase its product yield, increase its business opportunity, and so on. Similarly, one similar case study I would like to share is where we have seen one of our member organizations, again Melinda, who works in Gumla, which is about 100 kilometers of Ranchi, a small tribal region where, because of their installation of a mini grid, they were able to look at a series of innovations within those geographies. So right from moving the income of these farmers from 15,000 per month to up to 16,000. That is exactly what we're looking at, a doubling of farmers' income as part of our sustainability goals. The way they did that was that after introducing energy into their system, they started looking at innovations that can help them process, let's say, mustard, where they would process oil out of it through process, and then also connect them further with packaging and complete market linkages. That is one way of innovation that I would like to see in the energy sector, where, again, it does not just focus on energy generation, but goes beyond. Another part of innovation that we would like to see is how energy is financed today. I think quite well mentioned, Gaurav, that energy is, while the rates are coming down, the equipments are still quite expensive. The recovery over there is quite expensive. And when we think about it from an end user point of view, what kind of financing is available for end users? So some of our members have worked on different kinds of such financing models, like Simpa, where PayGo model was used, so that they are able to introduce these solutions into the communities and then increase their aspirations through different innovations. We have seen similar innovations come from Selco Foundation as well, where a blacksmith who has been typically relying on his muscle power to really hit his hammer is now powered through a solar panel, a simple, affordable solar panel, which now his wife can also run his shop in his absence. So those are the kind of small innovations that we in this sector are really looking at. And to some extent, all of us draw this inspiration from quite famous the three idiots model of Sonam Wangchuk, right? Where small disruptions can lead to mass level impact, and that is where we are looking at energy related innovations to also come through. Quite a few out there. It's not that they are not there. Today we call them jugads, but it's important to bring them into mainstream, to bring them into the right set of standards so that it can be brought at a mass level. It can be manufactured at a mass level. And someone did mention that India needs to go towards Atmanirbhar Bharat. And to some extent, without such innovations, we will still rely on imports and other such equipments to come in and help us, help our economy.
So I remember you are absolutely right about using Lohar's, using the solar panel. So this few months back, I visited the Uttarakhand, and one of the friend who is a professor in the local university, he took me to Gharars. There are 3,000 Gharars of water mills in Uttarakhand, and some of these Gharars are now using not only for using the power of water to get their job done, but also generating small amount of power, which is good enough to use at their homes for their businesses. And some of them even gone further and even started supplying to 4 or 5 houses. So I absolutely agree. So I think the last mile innovation in energy is more important than the breakthrough innovation. Breakthrough innovations are important, but given the condition what India has today, I think still the people are not able to get energy despite of we being energy surplus, and many of the panelists have said, just because the last mile innovation is not there. So at this stage, we will move to the question and answer session. There are a lot of questions which have already been asked here. I'll read out few questions since we only 10 minutes. So one of you can answer one question. I'll not take the name of every person, but it will take time. So today PM announced the huge package for coal industry is an open market for coal. Is there really India's outlook for renewable energy and sustainable development? There's another question specifically, Gaurav. What's your view on imparting skills to youth for challenging youth workforce, solar energy sector? That thing we can avoid because that will take a lot of time. The first question we can take. The another question is about how to economies energy, solar energy. I think there's some typo. How economy solar energy storage and battery to reuse at night. So that's another interesting, it's a grassroots question, but how you can use those batteries at night, how the storage has happened. So same way, I'm sure one of the questions which people like to ask is that why, when the petrol prices are going down, why our own petrol pump prices are going up worldwide. So then there is there's a non-relevant question about how you give insights on how we can have a manufacturing flexibility in India, not relevant to this topic. What are the challenges for sustainability development in India? What should be the basic thing in order to eliminate the challenge? Again, may not be relevant for this particular panel. What should be the learning pathway for a student who wants to work in the renewable energy industry? How can youth of the country move in the direction of becoming a founder of new energy industry? I think I love this question. This is the question should be what the youth should do so that they can, they are not only reducing the emissions but also providing jobs. I think this is the question we should certainly take it up. I like to know whether the large solar panel can be how the robotic cleaning is cost effective. I'm sure Edison, you have asked this question. Please write to Gaurav Sood. He'll be delighted to take you through how robot cleaning can be done. So the one-to-one question, you can take it up on one-to-one basis. Then there is India 100% Atmanirbhar in making solar panels and international corporate price? Answer is no. If you have read the last few days newspaper, Adani has said within 2 years they will start manufacturing solar plants in India. As of now, I'm sure the panelists are correct. More than 75% of dependence of solar panel isn't from China. Not India is definitely not Atmanirbhar at any way. How India can start innovating and not just using technologies from West, again may not be relevant for this panel. So one of the questions which I would definitely the panelists is that what should the learning pathway for a student who want to work in a renewable energy industry? How can youth of the country move in the direction of becoming a founder in new energy industry? That's our innovation and entrepreneurship question. Please take it up. Anybody wants to answer?
If I can take a quick shot.
Sure.
Okay. For me, I think more than an answer, for me, it is a pitch to the youth that, Clean has a group of about 210 enterprises. Most of them are run, managed, and operated by youth who are looking at specific problems on field and trying to solve it with energy. So I think one way that we have seen such successes come through is by actually putting hands on the ground, working with some of these enterprises, or would be happy to help you out as well as a network.
Yes, just adding on, every year we take interns in our enterprise, and we have been of late having interns even from foreign countries and interns from Japan, from the US. So there is a tremendous amount of interest on how to become a social entrepreneur at a larger scale, because the youth who's seeing the social problems of the country are linking the energy and social impact nexus. And so there's a tremendous interest on how I can contribute, how can I contribute to the society using the energy abundance, if I can put it that way. So there are many ways. So there are many companies like us who would welcome the students to become interns. And these internships are not 1 week, 2 weeks. It's minimum 6 months. It goes for a year. That's what we do. And we give you a solid project. Either, for example, we have designed a portable or a hanging wind turbine. Wind turbines are always mounted on, even if it is a small wind turbine on a rooftop, it is mounted on a mast. We have created a wind turbine which can hang on a rope, and you can actually fold it, put it on the backpack. This was designed specifically for our soldiers in Siachen, because there is no solar there, or even if you can put a solar, it's going to be sunk in 20 foot snow. So the only way that he can charge the satellite phone is by having a wind turbine in his hand. Otherwise, he has to receive down by 400 400 to 500 meters. And so this kind of innovation are articulated. We have a problem statement and we help them to, you know, complete this. And we have a tie-up with CSIR in Chennai and IIT Madras, and we take it to the next stage. If DST can fund it for the commercialization, we do that. So one or two of them have been taken forward. So a number of innovations are happening, and that's one way. The second way is that you look at the problem and then look at the solution. For example, e-mobility is going to be the thing of the day in the coming days. You know, as the battery, as Gaurav said, as the battery prices keep falling down, it will become more and more affordable to go into e-mobility. And there's going to be a lot of innovation on that front. There's a tremendous need for solar-powered or renewable energy-powered charging stations. So we can make a directory of, I would think that I have at least identified about 200 different opportunities. So if anybody is interested, he's most welcome, he or she is most welcome to contact me, and I'm happy to share our experience.
So here you go, guys. So 200 opportunities are waiting for you. If I am looking for a job, I will definitely, end of this call, I'll send my resume to Raghu.
Yeah.
Or at least ask him to give me one project so that I make money out of it, but I also provide jobs. So we are just 2 minutes away before the session ends. So last words from Gaurav.
No, I mean, if you want me to talk about the same thing, surely the large scale utility play is very capital intensive. We all understand.
Question wala kahan aisa nahi
dekha. When I'm talking to enter, you require a large capital to be fixed behind your back. Today, all the IPPs in India are backed by private equity funds, pension funds, infrastructure funds. Without that, this play is not possible. When it comes to, I mean to say, as entrepreneurial opportunities, I think distributed generation is the place to go. And the second part is that India has not done very well in this sector so far. There are again some regulatory challenges, but once those challenges are addressed, this is something which needs to be focused in a big way. And every country, I would say, has gone first residential or residential, then utility. We have straight away jumped onto utility. We are trying to get into distributed, but that needs to be really pushed in a big way. And there will be a lot of opportunities, be it as integrators, be it as service providers, in terms of maintaining now with, you know, so there are ample opportunities. And as Mr. Raghuraman mentioned, and as Advait mentioned, that there are a lot of companies which are working in these sectors, and they need young blood to be a part of it, learn along with them, and as you dirty your hands, you will get a lot of ideas to start your own ventures and to cater to the actual issues on the ground. So overall, once again, I would say that renewables, I always say India is one of the few countries in the world where you can say that I can set up a 2 gigawatt business on the utility scale, of course, in the next 3 to 4 years. But even in the distributed, the market is huge. It is not an easy market. It's a very competitive market. So you have to be ready with your entrepreneurial spirits, whether you're playing at utility or a small sector level. But this is the sector to be in. In the coming years, no second thoughts. Thank you.
Nikhil, I'll just take one question. There's a very interesting question. How can we go with schools and telling the students? Do we have a minute to talk about it?
Sure, please.
Just to answer this question, we had a program called Wind for Schools. So, just a point that we were making until recently, because the solar has now crashed. When I started this business, cost per watt, the manufacturing cost or the installation cost per watt of solar and wind was more or less the same. If any, wind was cheaper than solar at that point of time, 9 years back. Now it's like 1/3 or even 1/4. So very few people take wind turbines, so we have scaled down our production. And so is the whole industry, the small wind industry. There are only 5 manufacturers approved by the government of India. But we do have a program where we give the turbines at a highly subsidized cost, almost at the manufacturing cost, to the schools, and we call it as Win for Schools program, so that this is for class 9, 10, 11, 12 children, because there is so much, there is not much to study about a solar panel, because it is fixed and it just generates. I mean, you can study, but wind is absolutely fascinating. You know, at different points of the day, at different points of the year, at different points of the, you know, time of the, you know, hour, and it varies, and especially if it is a horizontal axis wind turbine, how the yaw moves. There is so much of physics, there is so much of mathematics children will learn, and that's the best way to create a young scientist. So I'm happy to help you on this. Whomever is interested in this, please reach out to me on email. Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
So wonderful. Thanks a lot, everybody. One thing I can guarantee, after this session, you will be receiving a lot of emails. So my request to Miraculous team is to put out your emails and phone numbers online so that you can become part of one more group. We are already part of 100 plus WhatsApp groups. We are consuming energies like more than anything else. One thing which I learned in the COVID time is that my screen time has increased. So I'm sure everybody is sitting at home, everybody is using ACs. So more energy is consumed at home. I'm not sure about offices, how much energy they are saving, but the home usage is definitely going up. So the energy will take shape, change shape in terms of usage, in terms of the end consumers, that we definitely know. So we require new models to come up, new ideas to come up. Energy innovation is the key. Till the time the humanity is there, energy requirement will be there. There's no question about it. It is like a roti kapda in makan, not Devang Mehta used to say a roti kapda or makan or Wi-Fi. I think the Wi-Fi needs energy to be played. So today is quite clear about it. Such a pleasure to host Advait, Gaurav and Raghu today for this session. Thanks a lot to Miraculous. Thanks a lot all of you guys for listening. And please reach out to us for any other further questions. Bye-bye. Over to you, Vishal.
Thank you, Nikhil. Thank you. Wonderful.
Thank you, Raghu.
Thank you.
I'm putting in my email ID as well, so that we can, if anybody would like to reach out to Clean, please feel free to write on it.